Good evening and welcome to Tucker Carlson Tonight. Smallpox, the bubonic plague, the Spanish flu. Those are some of the many diseases that have changed the course of history over the last few thousand years. Here's a new one bound for the DSM, Trump derangement syndrome. It's a particularly insidious illness because it doesn't merely affect individuals, but entire political parties, rendering them unrecognizable. Until about 20 minutes ago, for example, the Democrats saw themselves as the party of reason, resistant to superstition and mass hysteria. They were, as they often told you, the party that fought McCarthyism. Now, it's the party that engages in McCarthyism enthusiastically. Watch.
This is nothing short of treasonous because it is a betrayal of the nation. He is giving aid and comfort to the enemy.
I think Donald Trump is a fascist. I think everything he stands for is disgusting.
That is pure racism. And the president is cynically using that racism to appeal to his base.
That is not what you see in a democracy. That is exactly what you see in authoritarian regimes.
They dare me to say impeach him. Today I say impeach 45.
Speaking of hysteria, Maxine Waters, of course, did not stop there. She urged her followers to hunt down and harass anybody tied to the Trump administration.
If you see anybody from that cabinet in a restaurant, in a department store, at a gasoline station, you get out and you create a crowd. And you push back on them. And you tell them they're not welcome.
Oh, and they obeyed. And as a result, this happened. This is all rage by proxy, of course. They'd like to hurt Trump himself, but he's not around, so they attack his employees and supporters. And in the absence of any of those, a star on the sidewalk with his name on it. Watch this. That's how it started, but smashing the star did not cool the emotions of the star smashers. Now the star is a venue for street fights.
I don't give a f- what you gonna do?
Get out of my
face. We're deep
face.
In here. We're deep right
get
here.
Get out of my
what
face.
We're deep right here.
Get out of my face.
We're deep right here.
Get out of my face.
Hear that? What you haven't heard are Democratic leaders appealing for calm. The Democratic Party at this point has become totally unmoored from whatever principles once defined it. Under Franklin Roosevelt, Democrats championed working Americans and organized labor. They couldn't do that today. Too many union members are middle-aged white guys. Instead, their only remaining principle is hatred of the president. If Trump supports something, they're against it. If he's against it, they're huge fans, no matter what it is. Consider the events of the past few months. MS-13, for example, a deadly street gang that engages in sex trafficking, rape, drug smuggling, torture, murder with knives. MS-13 preys on poor people, mostly immigrants. The president called them animals because they are. Within hours, the left produced a wave of speeches and op-eds extolling the basic human dignity of gang members with face tattoos whose motto is kill, rape, control. Once they embraced MS-13, the left decided that the law enforcement agency charged with arresting MS-13 must be bad, hence the now common demand that ICE be abolished so that immigration laws can never again be enforced. And then there's Stormy Daniels. Even on the far left, hardcore pornography was not considered an ideal career for your daughter. And then Daniels and her creepy cable-friendly lawyer emerged, and now Daniels is touted on the left as some sort of civil rights hero. When Rudy Giuliani doubted her credibility, he was blasted for impugning the respectability of women who have sex with strangers on camera for pay. Well, for years, the left was even more adamant than the right in demanding free speech for Americans and good for them. And then came Trump. Free speech allowed Donald Trump and his supporters to be heard, so now the left is against free speech. They're begging Facebook and Twitter to suppress the opinions they dislike and censor news outlets that don't toe the new Democratic Party line, the line that has existed for about 15 minutes. The left also used to worry about the unchecked power of the most powerful sectors of our government, the CIA and the FBI and the whole constellation of alphabet agencies. They worried that those bureaucrats might violate civil liberties at will. They might spy on Americans. They might hide all of that beneath the black cloak of the word classified. Now those agencies have used their power to spy on Trump's associates and leak damaging information about the administration to the press. Suddenly, the left considers them, these unaccountable members of the deep state, heroes. How about this one? For decades, the left accused the rich of not paying their fair share of taxes. Okay, last year's tax reform bill rolled back the amount of state and local taxes rich people can deduct. Now that the wealthy, though, form the core of the Democratic Party's constituency, liberals are outraged by this. New York and New Jersey are suing the Trump administration to get the rich their tax deductions back. We could go on and on and on. George W. Bush embroiled America in a ruinous Middle Eastern war. The left hated him for that. Now he gave a speech criticizing Trump last year, so he's fully rehabilitated. The left used to fear corporate control of major news outlets, and they should. But after President Trump attacked the Washington Post as a mouthpiece for Amazon mogul Jeff Bezos, a USA Today columnist said those critiques were, quote, attacks on the First Amendment, as if they defend the First Amendment. They don't. President Trump tweeted threats at Kim Jong-un, so his sister was praised at the Winter Olympics for stealing the spotlight from Vice President Pence. She must be great. The president hates her brother. President Trump wants better relations with Russia and peace in Syria. So naturally, all the geniuses in Washington tell us we have to prepare for war against both countries. To anyone who remembers the Democrats of the 1960s, the 90s, or even 3 years ago, it's all very confusing. That party is dead. It's been replaced by a new one whose entire platform could be say no to Trump. This isn't politics anymore. It's the world's dumbest religion. Tammy Bruce is a New York radio host, and she joins us tonight. How easy is the left to control that the president, whatever he says they oppose, I mean, he could oppose something that 99% of Americans are against, so the Democratic Party would be for it.
Yes, exactly. Great to be on set with you.
Nice
here,
to
too.
See you, Tammy.
Nice to see you, too. Look, this is, in a way, it's kind of strange and funny. We've accused the left of having Trump derangement syndrome as a mocking example of the fact that they just simply need to grow up, that this is something that is just this inability of people to acknowledge and to deal with a real life adult event that they lost an election. And now there's an effort to normalize being so damaged, if you will, by an external event that some U.S. psychiatrists now are saying they've got more patients with Trump anxiety disorder. Of course, none of that is really true or genuine. It is about people needing to grow up and deal with reality properly. But in the process, as you note, they, as liberals, are giving the president an enormous amount of control. Their lives and every moment of how they react to him is based on what he says. What he does. They have virtually, they've acceded complete control to him. If they stepped back for a moment and just realized that they could have some influence, that they could work in a dynamic to get their policies, their narrative, their preferences passed, maybe they would have some success. But now you've got leadership, as you played in the opening, encouraging this refusal to deal with reality, encouraging this dynamic that plays on effectively. It's almost an abusive dynamic, but it comes down to individual Americans deciding that they're going to be children at this point and
but
be angry
it's so
perpetually.
Weird. I mean, it's literally reactionary in that
literally.
They are reacting purely to him.
Exactly.
But I'm not sure I even really understand it. I think Trump is interesting, I guess. He's a politician.
Sure.
They find him the most fascinating person who's ever lived. There's nothing that Trump says or does that they don't obsess over. They're like stalkers. What about him drives them so bonkers?
And especially since the things that he does has improved everyone's lives. There is no doubt about that. ISIS is dead. MS-13 is being dealt with. Everybody's got more money in their pocket. The job economy is at historic lows. The job, the unemployment rate. There is no one who hasn't benefited from this, except, of course, ISIS and MS-13. What is it about him? That he's everything they thought couldn't exist. They had this idea. They were told certain things by their leadership of how it was going to be. And as a result, since everyone thought that it was going to be a certain way and they were promised certain things, Donald Trump represents the fact that the future maybe isn't controlled by them, that there is a different thing that can happen. And they're being encouraged by Democratic leadership to see this in a personal way, in exclusively an emotional way, in the most extreme fashion, appealing to the fringe. I can tell you, and I've said this before, that maybe we're not as divided as they say we are, that a majority of Democrats also agree with the benefit that the president is bringing us. Democrats are walking away from the party, that there is this shift in what's happening, and Democrat leadership simply was not prepared for this, and they feel that harassment of people who don't think like them is the easiest and best thing to do.
So they're failing, so they're hysterical. I just
literally,
it's an amazing moment. Tammy Bruce, yeah. Great to see you.
Thanks.
Thank you
for
very
having
much.
Me. Pleasure to be here.
Richard Goodstein is a lawyer. He advised Hillary Clinton's presidential campaigns. He joins us tonight. Richard, I never thought I would see a moment where Democrats are angry because a Republican has raised taxes on the rich. I never thought that would happen. And it's a measure. I mean, if there's one sort of core idea in the Democratic Party, it's the rich don't pay enough. So here, the Trump tax bill makes them pay more in certain places on the East Coast, in New York and New Jersey, and they're suing him for it. How does that work exactly?
Well, I think the core Democratic value is social and economic justice. And I think the feeling that most of these tax cuts went to corporations, and the evidence is pretty clear at this point. A, it's unpopular, the tax bill that passed. And B, it's not working. Most people's, the wages are flat in
no,
this
but
country.
That's
and,
not what
and
they're suing. But hold on, that's not
others,
what,
it's down.
But hold on, that's not what they're suing over. I mean, so Andrew Cuomo, who you'd have to think is one of the front runners for the Democratic nomination in 2020. He's not a minor figure in the Democratic Party. He's suing because Trump signed a bill that raises taxes on the rich, doesn't allow the deductions from the federal tax form on state taxes. And that only affects rich people. And he's outraged by that. Did you think that you would live to be old enough to see that? A standard bearer of progressive values angry that the rich are getting soaked? Seriously.
Yeah. So the truth is that, again, what the tax bill did was go after blue state wealthy people, right? That's what it did. Invariably, it hits states like New York and New Jersey and California
well, it has
and
others. States with high property taxes. But hold on. But the fact remains that Democrats are arguing that the rich pay too much in taxes in their state. I mean, maybe they do. I mean, whatever. I'm not a liberal, so I mean, I can kind of see the wisdom in that argument. But
yeah,
it suggests that whatever Trump is for, they're against. And that's not really a good way to chart your course as a political party, is it?
I think that's actually a distortion. What Democrats,
it's not a distortion.
Had they been in charge of Congress, would have passed legislation that would have indeed lowered tax rates for middle class and most wage earners, and probably would have either increased or kept current the rates for wealthy people. That's what Democrats would have done.
Okay,
instead.
So Trump raised taxes on the rich and the Democrats are mad. Look, I mean, I'm not criticizing him for that. I get it. It's just you're not acknowledging
how
weird
overall,
this moment is.
Yeah,
it's very
I think
weird.
Overall, talk to your friends. You're in New York now. Go up and down Wall Street and ask them whether they're paying higher or lower taxes. I think the answer is, notwithstanding the state and local tax deduction issue, most of them got a huge tax benefit
well,
out of this bill.
Well, they're all Democratic voters, as you know, the rich vote Democrat now. Did you ever think you'd see a moment where the Democratic Party defended the dignity of hardcore pornography? When Rudy Giuliani impugned the character of Stormy Daniels, who has sex with strangers on camera, the left almost unanimously said, whoa, there's nothing wrong with that. Did you ever think we'd get to that point? I mean, what is that? Is there a huge constituency of porn workers that you guys are trying to suck up to? Or like, what is that about?
I never thought we'd see a president on Air Force One deny something when he's asked the question about Stormy Daniels or Karen McDougal, and his lawyer admitted that he was lying. I never actually did think we would see that.
That's true.
That
was a wild moment. I agree. But it didn't speak to the principle of an entire party. I mean, is there a big constituency that thinks that pornographic actors don't get the respect they're due? Is that why Democrats are defending it? What about MS-13? Is there a big MS-13 constituency? They're like, you know what? We got to shore up the base with the MS-13 voters. Like, why are they defending MS-13? Any idea?
There's no constituency for tearing babies from mothers. I guarantee you both parties agree on that, right? Except for somebody in the White House and people who work for him
tearing
directly.
Tearing babies from mothers.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, that's what's happening.
Really, because it happens
to never going
to
see them again.
Because it happens to American citizens every single day, but nobody cares.
Because
they're boring American citizens. Every American with children, it's half of all federal prisoners, is separated from his kids, but nobody cares because they're not illegal aliens. So, like, who cares? They're just stupid Americans who voted for Trump. Like, no big deal. Where's the outrage for that? Any idea?
These people were getting traumatized in Central America. They come up looking for asylum.
Oh, but what about Utica?
And they will never
see them
again.
What about Youngstown? Do we not care about those people? They're not getting traumatized because they're separated from their kids by force. Men with guns separate from their children. Nobody cares because they're Americans, dummies. Yeah. They voted for Trump, right?
Well, I think people who go to jail, they've made choices that are different from the person trying to escape
who
persecution.
Who snuck into our
in
country illegally. They didn't make a choice by violating our immigration law. That was mandatory, I guess?
Yeah, I think we're talking about two different things.
We are talking about, I'm talking about Americans, you're talking about foreigners who break our laws.
I'm talking about people who have a, you know, the U.S. used to be sympathetic to people like this, and we're not anymore.
We should be sympathetic to Americans, I would say. Richard, great to see you. Thank you very much.
My pleasure. Thank you.
President Trump promised to build a wall on the border and carried the Republican Party to victory 2 years ago on that promise. Remember that? Elections are supposed to have consequences. This election didn't have a consequence, though, for congressional Republicans. They're still refusing to pay for the wall. Why is that? Lou Dobbs may have an answer. He joins us next from New York.
We are going to build a great border wall to stop illegal immigration. I would build a great wall, and nobody builds walls better than me, believe me. I'm going to stop illegal immigration and drugs coming into our country, and yes, we will build the wall.
We could spend the whole show playing those clips. It was the one thing Donald Trump was perfectly clear about as he campaigned for president. If elected, he would build a border wall on our southern border. On the strength of that promise, above all other promises, he beat 16 other Republican candidates, upset Hillary Clinton, and the Republican Party unexpectedly kept both houses of Congress. Where's the wall, by the way? Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell's position is, thanks for the votes, the wall, maybe later.
Is the funding of the border wall going to wait until after the midterm elections?
Probably, and that's something we do have a disagreement on. And
so Homeland Security won't get funded before the midterms?
Probably not.
Yeah, probably not, because there's a disagreement. But there's some consensus, too, on the Republican side. Republicans have been able to pursue tons of other priorities. They passed the largest corporate tax cut in history, expanded the H-2B foreign worker program. So who exactly is the Republican Party representing? Voters or a handful of donors? We think you know. Lou Dobbs has spent years thinking about this. He hopes Lou Dobbs tonight on Fox Business. He joins us tonight. I'm kind of speechless to this.
Well, that's the problem. One becomes, I mean, all of this becomes ineffable to describe, to accept, and to deal with, because it is so obviously toxic and corrosive. There are so many sellouts. You know that the Republican leadership in the House and the Senate are made up of acolytes of expediency and, of course, corporate America, the U.S. multinationals, and the Koch brothers, Wall Street, Business Roundtable, and the Chamber of Commerce. By the time you get through, there's no room for the American people, just 300 million of us. There's no room for the middle class, working men and women, and their families. That's why President Trump got elected. The American people sensed the inordinate power and corruption of the establishment, and that's why this anti-establishment president was elected.
But they're proving the point. So a lot of people voted for Trump because they thought, this isn't a democracy, it's an oligarchy, stop lying to me. Mm-hmm. And now they're proving that it's true. I mean, in a democracy, you would look and say, what's the thing that voters voted for in the last election? Let's try and do it. They're not even trying.
Yeah, they're not trying, and they're doing it rather snootily, I think, as well. I mean, probably not. Dismissive, superior, and oh, by the way, don't even pretend that you belong in the same room as me. Oh, unwashed, says Mitch McConnell. And Paul Ryan, he's talking about a better way agenda to compete, when in fact what they're both saying is we're going to do exactly what Charles Koch says. We're going to keep open borders. We're going to bring across as many illegal immigrants as possible. The middle class be damned, the working man and woman in this country be damned, America be damned. They're not going, even though they've styled it as such, going against Trump. They're going against this country and our most precious values and all that has made us great. And that's our middle class.
So why would people, I mean, apart from the fact the Democratic Party has actually gone off the deep end and is right. dangerous, leaving that aside, why would anybody vote for Republicans right now?
Right now, there's only one reason. His name's Donald J. Trump. He's the man who won the election. He is the reason the Republicans retained the House and the Senate. And there is no other explanation. And these fools leading the House and the Senate, Tucker, they really have decided that they can do this without Donald Trump. They don't have to affix themselves to the Trump agenda. They don't have to talk about deregulation. They don't have to look at all that he has achieved. This is already an historic president in a year, just over a year and a half, in office. It's remarkable.
But the second they get crushed, assuming, let's say the Republicans lose the House.
Yes, as they will likely will if they leave particularly Ryan in place.
But they're going to blame Trump.
Of course they will. That's the game. And the American people, they will know the reason. There's a party that's not worthy of their support, not worthy of their trust. There is a president, and this is going to be the great divide, because we are watching oligarchs like the Koch brothers carry out class warfare. Think of this. The Koch brothers, who have been synonymous with the Republican Party, are conducting class warfare against the middle class, the foundation of the country, working men and women, and saying, the hell with you, we can bring in illegal immigrants. We're going to arbitrage labor costs just as we've been doing around the world.
Lou Dobbs, not a word mincer.
No, sir.
Great to see you.
Great to see you,
Tucker.
Thank you.
Philadelphia's mayor is putting his citizens at risk for the